Everybody, I am Mark Carter with Midwest Astro, based out of Kansas City, Missouri, and today we're going to look at NINA, the Nighttime Imaging and Astronomy Tool. NINA is a free imaging acquisition software for deep sky astrophotography. While it is free, it is still recommended to donate to help them continue advancing this software through upgrades and enhancements. With that said, today this first video is going to be a part of a series. We're going to look at just setting up your configuration. Now, a lot of people have told me that NINA seems like there's a lot to it and they just don't know where to start, and they prefer things like the ZWO asiair. And it makes total sense. That is geared for pretty much anybody. And NINA, in my opinion, can be for your beginners, but I think it truly, if you have an advanced setup, it truly benefits you the most. But with that, let's just look at how to get started. So, with this, I have a couple different profiles that we'll look at here. So I'm just going to say load profile. Upon opening this for the first time, you may not actually have one like that. So here on the first screen, you're going to see there's basically two table of contents style tabs on your left-hand side. The left one will be where you're actually going to be navigating, and then the second one is going to be more like a ribbon that's associated to the equipment. So camera is part of equipment, filter wheel is part of equipment, so on and so forth. If I click these tabs over here, it'll take me to other pages entirely. So let's first start at this options page. So this is where we're going to kind of define our different profiles, our locations, and such. So when I get started, I have multiple different telescopes, so I like to make sure that I have multiple different profiles. That way my focal lengths are all recorded and they're all ready to go. When I load up the profile, I can just send it directly to that particular setup, and then I don't have to reconfigure anything. So over here, you could name your profiles. You can create new profiles. So let's say I want to take my Explorer Scientific. And let's say I want to create a new profile for it because I'm going to add another reducer to it, for example. So I can click this button, which is the copy button. You can see now it put a copy in, so I'm going to say load that profile. You can confirm which profile is active with the check mark over here on the left-hand side. Then the naming convention, you can call this, like let's say I added the Starozona Apex L, so maybe I just say Apex. For my naming conventions, I just have the telescope, my camera, and then which reducer or flattener that I typically use. With that, you can select your English. Mine's probably more appropriate for United States English, which is significantly different than UK English. You can change all of your fonts to be whatever you want. Probably wouldn't recommend the all squares. Never really understood those. But you can make sure that you have everything you have you need set up here. I do use the beta version, which you can see I'm on the beta 2.0. I feel like that's plenty accurate and it takes not much time at all out of my imaging. You can set up all of this stuff. I personally use the hyperbolic with trends, and then number of temps. You can set in one or leave it stock one or put in two, whichever you prefer. Use the brightest instars. I don't really use that unless you have a lot of big stars in your framing. With galaxy season, I definitely wouldn't use it because it might only be one star at all that you're going to be focusing on, and that's probably not enough of a sampling to get an accurate reading. Binning, leave it one. The R2 threshold, so that's essentially going to be what is the grade of your focus routine. So as you know, it's supposed to be kind of a U-shape when it runs the autofocus routine, and it'll grade effectively how smooth that transition is, as well as just simply how accurate it is. Using the hyperbolic with trends, sometimes your lowest point on the actual reading isn't necessarily where it might your best focus point might actually be. So it'll trend where the focus might actually be, and it might go to that point as your focal point to actually give you the best possible focus. This grades it, and it basically says if you get 70% score and above, you'll accept that. Most of the time I do 0.8, and that way it requires a little bit better of a focus. That also depends on the type of telescope you're going to use. Using a refractor with a wide field view, you could probably even take that to 0.95 because your stars are going to be a little bit smaller, they're going to be tighter, and they're going to be a little more accurate with your sampling. As you get into longer focal lengths, you might need that to be a little bit higher because your sampling rate may not be sufficient enough to give the best possible score on each frame, is what I have found at least. So, if you're using an off-axis guider, you're going to disable guiding during autofocus. Otherwise, your guiding will literally start chasing the stars. And then it's kind of obnoxious because you'll see your graph just jumping all over the place. So if you do use an off-axis guider, go ahead and turn that on. If you don't, I would just leave it off. Default autofocus, I usually just do 10 seconds, which is more than sufficient, even usually for my 3-nanometer SHO filters. It should be sufficient for pretty much everything else, as long as, again, your sampling rate is good. I also personally use the overshoot, and then usually somewhere about 150. This the step size and this backlash in and out, this will be custom to you. There's a few videos that are out there already that kind of go over this, but I'll try to hit this on a later video. But I typically use somewhere between 100 and 150 for both, and it's usually good enough that I get a good enough reading. So you can set your autofocus filter settings again down here. So our next tab, if you are fortunate enough to have a dome, congratulations, I do not. So I will be skipping that one because I cannot advise you on that. As far as imaging goes, this looks like a busy screen, but what this is over here, this image file pattern, this is where you're saying, what do you want to name your files as? And then these are all of your possible options. So if at the end here, your frame number, maybe you wanted to add, let's see what we've got here. Maybe you want to confirm your binning. Just double click it and it'll go up here. Maybe you want to add your gain just to make sure when you do your flats, you have the correct gain to match your lights. Maybe you want to know your exposure time. So you put that in there, and as you see, it's building it. And what I found that the easiest thing to do is there's going to be 1, 2, and then 1, 2. Is to put an underscore in between the 4 total dollar signs, and that way when you go to read it, you can see, oh, here's one number, here's another number, here's another, and then that way you should be able to more easily identify that the last number is going to be your exposure time or your gain. That'll become more apparent the more often you use it, the more you'll start to realize what your order is. The first couple of times you're kind of like, well, I forgot what this number is, but that'll come to you easily enough. Over here on the side, you have minutes after meridian. I typically leave that at 5 and then 10. And I pretty much just leave these settings as they are. With a refractor, it's not as important to do an autofocus after the flip, but if you're using a telescope like a Newtonian or a Schmidt-Cassegrain, due to mirror flop and shifts, it might not be a bad idea to run another autofocus just to make sure that if the mirror did shift at all, that you go ahead and get that accounted for. This annotate image, I recommend turning that on. That becomes important when you get to the actual imaging and you want to have your stars populate scores. That way you know what the HFR readings are. I don't really change annotate all. I'll turn that one on, and then really this is just where you're gonna save your files, so you'll want to simply update where those are. They're gonna be saved, so when you create a sequence for a target, it'll save in this location all on its own. So I just created a NINA folder, and then that way everything just saves there and I can find everything in one spot. And then plate solving, I do personally use ASTAP. You can go to the ASTAP location. I do not have it on this particular computer. It is on my mini PC, which I use for the actual imaging, as I am on my desktop computer here. With that, you're going to put in your install location for ASTAP, and then I think the rest of this you'll pretty much leave as is. So you'll define, you know, whichever one you want to use. My experience was PlateSolve 2 was a little slower. I found ASTAP was actually the fastest. And then I use ASTAP for both because astronomy.net, it takes a long time for it to tell you it can't solve it still. So I figured if it's going to fail, it might as well tell me a little bit quicker than waiting, you know, 10, 15 minutes for a queued website to process the image just to tell you that it doesn't know it. So once you've got all that set up, you don't need to go back here and click save or anything. It just automatically saves that way. So that's just getting your equipment, your options set up. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to go to the top here to the equipment, your camera. This is where you're basically going to connect everything. So here, if you have, you know, a ZWO camera, your ASCOM drivers will automatically populate into Nina. Again, I don't use this computer for imaging, so it's not going to be there. So I'm just going to say simulation camera. The filter wheel, same thing. Your ASCOM drivers will drive all of your connections. So you'll pick all of your choices, and then when you go in to actually do your imaging, all you have to do is click this power button. It looks like a power button to connect it. It'll say connect all devices, and you say okay, and then everything over here that you've defined as I use this will automatically connect for you, and you don't have to go to each individual thing to connect it like you do some applications. This will launch everything from your camera to your filter wheel to your guider to your weather, and if you have a dome, it'll connect your dome automatically. And then once you've just said what you have via, again, your ASCOM drivers, that's all you got to do here. That's all the equipment tab is for, is just connecting to those things. Your Sky Atlas, this is going to be your general catalog. You cannot, in my experience, look things up by their name. You need to actually have a catalog code to find anything. I find their search things are a bit confusing, so I've never actually used it. That's when the planetarium software comes into effect, and I will then, if it's linked, come to the framing, and then I can just click this little button right here, which is get the coordinates from a planetarium, or in this case, stellarium. So I can put something into stellarium, click this button, and it should automatically pull it over. I don't believe it's going to pull anything over right now. I don't have anything loaded, so it's going to give me an error message. So you can also type directly into this, and it will populate with options. So if you know your catalog code, that's going to help you out a lot. So if I say M16 is going to be my choice, and then I want a 3-degree field of view, I can say load image, and it will do so now. So with Nina, the nice thing is I can frame this image any way I want to. Maybe I don't want all of this nebulosity to this side, so maybe I want a little bit more this way, because as you can see, it's very busy over here to the left-hand side. There's a lot of hydrogen in that area, so I might want that particular area. The other option you have here is you can build mosaics. Now, the difference between building a mosaic here and other softwares is you sometimes have to have all of your coordinates to then manually plug into other applications. Not with Nina. Nina will do all of this for you. You can change your overlap, so maybe you need a wider field of view, but not a substantially wider, and then you want to get M16 in all of the frames and then get an equal frame. You can set it so the eagle is actually right in the middle, and then you'll see right here it builds all of your panels for you. For the sake of it, I'm not actually going to build those. We'll just leave it as is. Maybe you want a different framing. Maybe you want something a little bit more like so. And then you'll almost be perpendicular. It's obviously blown out, but it'll be pretty perpendicular with the actual pillars of creation right here in the center, so they'll look a bit better with this slight tilt. Then we can say slew and center, which if our telescope is connected, it will do that. It will slew and center on that particular target. Or from here, we can add it directly to our sequencers, either our simple sequencer or our advanced sequencer. We'll skip that for now, and we'll just keep going down the tabs here. The next thing is the flat wizard. I highly recommend utilizing the flat wizard. You can set up all of your filters to shoot during the flats sessions. If you just simply click them all on, and then what you can do is go to each one and you can divide. What is your shortest exposure? And what it'll do is based off the brightness of your maybe it's a t-shirt over the end of your telescope, it will actually advise you what at that brightness, how long it'll take to get, you know, 50%, 40% histogram with a plus or minus 10 variation in there. or a tolerance on either side of that. So just play around with your settings. These are all just simply dependent upon how bright your light is over the top of your t-shirts or whatever it is you're utilizing. Maybe it's paper dispersing the light from a tracing board. But play around with these settings, and then once you get them, they'll automatically store. You don't have to change them again. They'll be the same thing each time. The sequencer, as I described, will be a simple sequencer and an advanced sequencer. For the sake of this video, I'm going to just do a simple sequence, but we're going to follow these tabs first and we'll come back to it. I will do the advanced sequencer in another video because it is demanding and it might be a little longer in general, so to keep this video somewhat short. This is the imaging page that I have set up for here. Now, you can customize this, you can change this however you would like. This is just going to be essentially your monitoring panel. I can see the image history, I can see my sequence information once it's set up, I can change if I need to take single shot exposures, I can see my statistics. That's going to give me all my HFR information as well as this down here. Just a lot of really good information. Once your images start to come in, you'll be able to see them right here. I can see what my filter wheel's doing, what my telescope's doing, what the weather is. I can get all of that onto a single screen. And that way I can truly monitor what is happening. And then if I want to add anything, maybe I have a flats panel, I can click it on and then you'll see it put it right here. But maybe I want to group this with something else. Maybe I want to put this with the weather. All I have to do is click, hold, and drag it, and once you get it to a panel, you'll see, do I want the full panel? Maybe I only want this bottom half, or maybe I want to split it to the right, to the top, and to the left. But I'm going to share it with the whole thing, so I'll put it right over here, and now you will see I can flip between weather and flat panel. And I can drag and hold to reorder them if I want them in a particular order here. So you can add as many things as you would like, as many things that are actually applicable, and kind of go from there. Maybe you have a rotator. So once you click it, now we just got to quickly find where it went, and you can see it's a tab right here. Maybe we don't want it right there. Maybe we want to put it, I don't know, with the telescope, or maybe we want it in its own space. We can customize this entire page to your liking. This is specific to you, and you don't have to save it. Once it's set, it is set. If you want to make changes, just simply click, hold, and drag and drop. Very simple. We've already gone over the options page. I'm going to load up this profile. There we go. On this page, you can install a lot of different plugins. One in particular that is going to be pretty handy if you decide that you want to get notifications will be for the pushover app. I'll get into that though with our advanced sequencer, because that's really the only time you can use that particular one. But you can do, you know, three point polar alignment, which is what I use. You just simply install it, and then you'll have to restart Nina. So if you're gonna do multiples, go ahead and install those. I don't know everything about each of these, but they all do have their own particular processes. So here's an artificial horizon generator, ground station, which is where you can use the pushover app. But yeah, once it's installed, it tells you that you need to do a restart. And then on the imaging tab, I just put in my polar alignment option just right here, and then we can do another video live the next time that I'm able to actually get out and do that. So with that, let's do a simple sequence. Let's just stick with M16. We've already got it built. Once we have loaded the image, we've set our framing the way we want, we go to add to simple sequencer. This will pull up your tab to start building your plan. So let's expand these options just to make sure we have everything. So we're not going to worry about a delay start. You want to make sure your cool camera is on if you have a cooled camera. Unpark the mount, yes, and meridian flip, yes. We want to turn all that on, and then once we're done, we will go ahead and warm the camera and park the mount. We can see M16 is our target and set up. So now what we're going to do is say slew to target, center the target, and start guiding. I don't use a rotator and I'm not going to worry about the rotation, but you can turn that on. Not going to worry about it for this particular setup. So then here on start, we want to do an autofocus. Maybe we want to do a filter change or an autofocus on filter change. And maybe if our HFR increases by 10%, we want to run a new autofocus. Then from here, all I have to do is, if you're using one-shot color, you can build out, let's say, 50 shots at 180 seconds each. We're going to do light frames. We're going to pick our L Pro, for example. We'll leave our binning there. I do want to probably dither every, we'll say, 2 frames. And then when you set up your camera, you can have it default your typical camera gain and offset values. For the ZWO ASI 2600 MM Pro, I always use 130. And that's the settings that I have elected to use always. If you do monochrome, you can leave that as is. Maybe you only want to do, let's say, 15 shots of 600 seconds. And let's say you want your hydrogen. But then you want to easily copy that because you're going to use other filters, but you want the same duration and you just want to tweak a couple things. Right down here, you can click your plus and it will copy your last row. So maybe we want to make this oxygen. And then we click plus, and then maybe we want to make this one sulfur. But maybe we only want like 5 and 5 because on average you'll typically do 2 hydrogen. You'll do 2 times the value of your oxygen and sulfur. So if you do, 10 here, you might just do 10 here. And that way you get more hydrogen, since that's going to be more prominent with your emission nebulae. So that's essentially how to set up your NINA configuration and get going in imaging right away. Again, if you want to connect all of your things at the same time, you don't even have to click on this equipment tab. Just simply click your power tab and it will say, do you want to connect all of your devices? And you just say, okay. It will connect your camera, your mount, your weather app, if you, set that up in your configuration over here with your weather, your options with your weather settings. Just go through here and just make sure in your options that you've configured your telescope, your name. All of this information will save into your FITS files as well, so that's very beneficial if you need to look back and try to see what was the weather at this time, or any information that could be embedded within that FITS file, you can get it by accurately setting up your options here. So I will leave you with that. If you have any questions, comments, definitely put those in the comment section below. I'm happy to help as much as I can, post new videos if that's going to help, or answer any questions that just come up on the rise. So with that, I will bid you clear skies and have a good day.